All right, well, we're going to be reading out of Luke chapter 12, and we're going to start in verse 13. I titled this morning's message, Don't Worry. And I started to say, don't worry, be happy, but that was some kind of crazy old song that I remember whenever I was a teenager. I think it was when I was a teenager. I don't know. Life goes by so fast now. So we're going to start reading in Luke chapter 12, verse 13, and we're going to read through verse 31. It says, in one of the company. Now, the word company right there literally means crowd. It's describing a crowd, or sometimes in the definition it described a throng. One word it used was rabble. And so there were a lot of different people that were showing up and congregating in large numbers to hear what it was that Jesus had to say. But that didn't mean that they were all true followers of the Lord, right? And one of the people that was in this crowd or amongst the rabble stands up and he wants to know. He says unto Jesus, he says, Master, speak to my brother that he divide the inheritance with me. And he said unto him, this is Jesus talking now, Man, who made me a judge or a divider over you? And he said unto them, Take heed and beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth. And he spoke a parable unto them, saying, The ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, What shall I do? Because I have no room where to bestow my fruits. Now, right off the bat, before we get going real good, you know, he was worried because he had too much and he didn't know what it was that he was going to do with what he had. And sometimes, you know, when I was reading it, when I kept going back and reading it again and again, it doesn't even seem like the thought ever crossed his mind to try to reach out and to give any of what he had to anybody else. But the true gospel, when it reaches and touches your heart, it begins to change your heart. And you become less consumed with yourself and the things that you're going to bring to yourself. And you become concerned about other people. As a matter of fact, if you'll go to Acts chapter 2, verses 45 through 47, we see in the early church that when the Holy Spirit began to deal with people's hearts, what happened was is that he began to change them. They became a lot less selfish. They started to become selfless. And they started to have a desire to reach out to one another. It says in Acts 2, 45 through 47, and sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house did eat their meat, which is just another word for food, with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. So as people were getting saved, as the church was coming together, the Holy Spirit was dealing with people's hearts, and he was giving them a hunger and a desire, if you will, to reach out and to share with other people. But that's not the story that we're reading this morning about this rich man whose ground is producing plentifully. He's worried about how he's going to be able to hold on to all the stuff that he has. And so we'll go back to verse 18 in that story. And he said, this is what I'll do. He figured it out. He said, I will pull down my barns and I'll build greater. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thy ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said unto him, you fool, this night your soul shall be required of you. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So is he that lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. So one of the things that, you know, God, that the Lord is pointing out in here, he didn't say that it's not okay to lay up treasure for yourself or to save. As a matter of fact, there's, you know, a couple of proverbs and there's some various wisdom scriptures that talks about the fact that there's nothing wrong with saving. But the issue is that this man's heart was that he was so consumed and concerned about himself and saving for himself, but yet at the same time, he was not rich towards God. And what was at the essence is not only is he covetous, but he's worried. There's a worry that's connected to his desire or his concern that he's not going to have what it is that he needs. And so he's trying to figure out things in his own strength and his own wisdom to make things happen. And this is a mistake that people make where they consume themselves with making this life better, but don't really ever truly live for God. And then it turns around and the man that Jesus says unto his disciples, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat neither for the body what you shall put on. And so, you know, in the middle of all this, I'm thinking the member of the rabble, he wants his fair share, right? He went, hey, our parents died, my daddy died. I want you to make my brother divide all the goods, make sure I get my fair share. So the member of the rabble wants his fair share. The rich man fears he won't have enough when his ground was already plentiful. But Jesus wants his disciples to be confident and to know that God is going to take care of them. And that no matter what it is that they're going through, they can trust and they can be assured in their hearts that as they're going through this life, that God will take care of them and he will meet their needs. And Jesus goes on to say, the life is more than meat, once again food. The body is more than raiment, meaning clothing. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse nor barn, and God feeds them. How much more are you better than the fowls? And which of you, with taking thought, can add to a stature one cubit? If ye then be not able to do that which is least, why take ye thought for the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They toil not, they spin not. And yet I say unto you that Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. So he's saying, look at the lilies of the field. You see, from time to time, in certain times of the season, the flowers would bloom. And when you look at the lilies of the field, they would be beautiful. And basically he was saying the earth is clothed with the beauty of these flowers. They don't toil, meaning they don't work. They don't spin. They don't have a loom over there making fabric in order to be able to sew clothing. And yet at the same time, the beauty of these lilies is more beautiful than any clothing that Solomon in all of his wisdom and all of his grandeur could have ever had or clothed himself with. And he's connecting that also to the ravens, the fact that they're not over there planting seed, they're not harvesting seed, yet God is able to feed them and take care of them. And he wants his disciples to know that they're more important than any of these things and that God was going to take care of them. He says, O ye of little faith, and seek not what ye shall eat or what you shall drink, neither be ye of doubtful mind to be anxious. This word doubtful describes being anxious or having a doubtful mind. And so once again, we see this same picture repeating itself where he can sense it in their hearts, or he can sense that once he's gone that they're going to be concerned or going to be worried, right, his disciples. And so that's really what the majority of this is for Jesus to encourage his people, his followers. For all these things do the nations of the world seek after. So he's talking about the world right there. And your Father knows that you have need of these things, but rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and these things shall be added unto you. So in this parable that we're reading, the rich farmer was actually worried because he had too much and he didn't know what he was going to do with all of his extras. So his plan was that he would tear down, he'd build bigger so that he wouldn't lose his surplus. Now, I know that there are people in this world that have this concern because, like, you know, there's people that have so much money that they really don't even know what to do with it. They get concerned that their money's just sitting in a bank collecting 3%, 4% interest, and they're always looking for some kind of deal to put their money in. I don't know a whole lot of people like that, but I've actually talked to people that way before, and even though my dad wasn't that rich, I can remember one time I asked my dad to borrow some money. He said, yes, son, you can borrow some money. I'll just charge you 12% interest. He said, you know, and I think his point was he was trying to teach me, you know, not to be dependent on other people, and that, you know, he was going to get something out of the deal. He never really asked me to pay the money back. But his point was, you know, I need to earn some money on my money, too. You know, the Bible says don't charge people usury. But Dad didn't know the scriptures that well. Nevertheless, so the point that I'm trying to make is that a lot of times people have that problem. They have so much money that they're looking for to be able to put their money in a particular place, you know, so that they can make money. But that's oftentimes not the problem that believers have, right? Many times believers have the opposite struggle, a struggle where we become overly concerned and worried about how we will take care of tomorrow, and in the process, we let the work of God pass us by. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? I can remember a long time ago thinking to myself, you know, after the Lord got a hold of me, I used to sit down, I went to church, I tried to read my Bible, but I would sit down in the recliner, and that was back before the Lord delivered me from dipping. I can just remember I had a big old dip in my lip, and I'd sit there and I'd watch baseball on television, and I'd flip through the channels. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, after the Lord got a hold of me, how much of my life was just being wasted? How much of it was just going by? And so oftentimes we get consumed and we're so worried about the things of tomorrow and how tomorrow's going to look that we never really accomplish anything for the Lord. And I can remember thinking and saying, you know, I don't want my life to be this. I don't want to just sit in this chair right here and just flip through the channels for the rest of my life. I want to do something for God. Amen. I want to have an impact. And however small it is, however big it is, I want to be used by God. I believe that God is real. And I believe that He has work that He desires to do in people's hearts and lives. And I want to be used by Him. Amen. In whatever capacity that He sees fit. I don't know if you've ever thought that before, but I know that I certainly have. And so we look around it many times in our lives, though, we have a hard time. I mean, you know, Jesus talked about it in the parable of the sower. And I mentioned this a lot of times, that some of the seed fell amongst thorns. And the thorns grew up at the same time as the seed of the gospel. That's what the seed represented. The sower was Jesus. It was the word. The word is a seed that comes into our heart. Amen. And it takes root in our lives. It begins to grow in our lives. It begins to cause a hunger and a thirst for the things of God, for the kingdom of God. But some of that seed fell amongst the thorns. And the thorns grew up at the same time as the seed of the gospel. It began to wrap itself around the gospel seed. And it began to choke the life out of it. And the truth is that many times whenever we are in this world, we see what other people have around us. And you're not going to convince me. I don't care how holy you are, how much you love God. You're not going to convince me that not each and every one of us in this room haven't at some point in time looked at what other people had and wished or compared our lives to them and wanted to have what other people have, or we began to think that this was what success was, right? To have what other people have, or to move, I need a better car, I need a better house, I need better clothes, and various things like that. And that's really the mindset of the world, is trying to convince us that that's what it is that we need. And you know, what Jesus said was, hey, life is more than meat, it's more than food, the body's more than clothing, right? And we have to understand that this stuff is going to perish away. And we need the Lord to give us a revelation of that this stuff is going to perish away, and that we have to have a desire. We want a desire to do the things of God. But we look around at what everyone else has and we compare it to what we don't have, and we allow ourselves to become convinced that somehow the meaning of life is found in the things we own. So we spend all our time working for more, but we don't stop long enough to work for God. Sometimes there are legitimate concerns. There are things that we can't see how or when God is going to accomplish these things in our life. I mean, the reality is that sometimes we have real stuff that's going on in our lives and we wonder, God, how are you going to fix this? How are you going to fix this situation? How are you going to accomplish this in my life? But the question that we have to ask is whether or not we will trust Him to do His will for us, or whether we will create, because of our worry, our own will for our own lives. It should be understood that there is nothing wrong with saving and being a good steward with what God gives us. I wanted to balance that out with what we're talking about. In Proverbs 21 verse 20, the proverb talks about that, wisdom literature. Now, if you read it in a newer translation, it'd probably be more easily understood. But it says, there is treasure to be desired and oil in the dwelling of the wise, but a foolish man spends it up. What he's talking about is, if you go to the house of a wise man, you're going to find out that he's got some treasure in there and he's got some oil stored up. He's got some oil ready for the day down the road when he needs it. He's got some money saved up. But the foolish man, he spends it all up. There's never any extra food. You know, whenever harvest comes, you know, we have a couple of people in the church that actually, during the after they grow gardens and stuff, and they do canning, you know. And so I don't know how you do it, but you know what I'm talking about, them old mason jars. And they can food. And so they got food stored up in their house. And so, you know, the reality is that if the Lord tarries, I got to be perfectly honest with you. I kind of hope that I have a little bit of some retirement money or something. I don't know if Social Security is going to be here when it's all said and done. You know, I want to try to be more wise with my money and save up, because I don't think that my daughters are going to want to take care of me when I'm old, you know? And anyway, nevertheless, it's a good thing to be wise and to be a good steward with your money. But at the same time, this rich man that we're talking about, that's not really what's going on. He's consumed with it. He's consumed with his work. He's consumed with saving. He's consumed with making sure that he's going to have enough for tomorrow. And it doesn't have to just be money and savings or a retirement plan. It doesn't have to be that. It can be other things that are going on in our life, other concerns, worries that we have. How is God going to fix this situation, right? And there's nothing wrong with the things of life that are legitimate that we should have some concerns about, but we should not be taking matters into our own hands and attempting to fix them or remedy them in our own strength and in our own wisdom, or allowing them to control our lives.
Amen.
In the sense that we don't know how we're going to get out of it, and we're allowing it to control our lives, right? We need to, what Jesus was wanting his disciples to understand is, y'all need to trust me in all of this.
Yeah.
So out of worry and fear that he would run out, the rich man prepared himself to hold on to his riches the best way that he knew how. He built more and bigger to store all that he had, but one day his life was over, and he couldn't bring that stuff with him. His soul was called on, and God called him a fool. God called him a fool because all his strength, all his decisions, all his work went into focusing on his present life, and when that life was ended, he hadn't invested anything into the kingdom of God. So I don't know, this morning's message might be real short, to be honest with you. I don't typically preach short messages, but this one might be short. This is point number one. Don't worry because it won't help. Amen. It's not going to do you any good to worry. I tell people a lot of times, you know, sometimes I don't have that great of a day, but I always try to put a smile on my face. I'm not trying to be fake, but everybody doesn't want to hear about my problems and they don't want to deal with my stuff, you know. And, there have been a couple of times when people say, how you doing today? I'm like, do you really want to know? or whenever I've asked people, you know, how are you doing? And they're like, well, you probably don't really want to hear about it. Well, I try to take that opportunity to say, no, actually, I would like to hear about what's going on in your life, you know, so that I can try to hopefully maybe minister to them. Sometimes that's an easy open door, mm-hmm. you know. But one of the things that I've learned, and I think my dad used to say this a lot too, it's not going to do me any good to complain about it because it doesn't fix anything. And the same thing about complaining is not going to fix anything. The same thing about worry, it's not going to fix anything. It's not going to change anything. And that's what Jesus was saying in this passage of scripture when we were talking about reading it earlier. He said, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat, neither for the body what you shall put on. The life is more than meat. The body is more than raiment. The words take no thought in this verse is the same Greek word that's found in the word translated as careful in Philippians 4:6. If you could go to Philippians 4:6 real quick. It says, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. The word careful, really, it's not that, you know, I've explained this to you before, at least in the past I have. It's not that you shouldn't put your seatbelt on. I still ignore that thing sometimes. It keeps dinging in my ear. You need to put your seatbelt on, right? There's nothing wrong with being careful, and that's not what it's talking about. It's talking about anxiousness. It's talking about to be anxious or to be troubled with cares, to care for or look out for one's own interests. So you're allowing things to rule you in such a way that it's causing anxiety in your life. That's what Paul is telling the Philippian church. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Yes, there's things that are going on in your life. Yes, there are legitimate issues and concerns and things that you're aware of. But guess what? Don't be overly anxious. Don't be allow yourself to be troubled down with them. Instead, you can bring them to the Lord. Amen. You can bring them to the Lord with a heart of thanksgiving, knowing that God cares for you and that he desires to take care of your situations and your needs. Amen. And you need to understand this. I want you to know that. See, right here, this is practical Christianity. In other words, the Apostle Paul is saying, listen, there are things that you can do. Yes, it's spiritual. You're going to bring it to the Lord in prayer. But at the same time, it's practical. It's literally something that you can do. You can bring it to the Lord in prayer. But one thing that I need you to understand is that the Apostle Paul never really taught about practical Christianity till at some point in the letter he would talk to them about spiritual understanding. And what I need you to know is that the gospel, now many times I've talked to y'all before about this, I've explained on numerous occasions that the word gospel means good news. Amen? The good news about Jesus, the good news about the Father, and that He has a plan, amen, to create covenant with us. What covenant means an agreement, amen? God has an agreement with mankind. And we talked about the fact that before there was ever good news, there was bad news, right? And the bad news is that Adam fell. And that each and every one of us was born of Adam, born with a sinful nature, born separated from God, separated from the presence of God. But God has good news.
Yes.
The good news is that He created a nation out of one man named Abraham, and through that nation He gave us the man Jesus, and in Jesus He's creating a peculiar people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. He's creating the people of God, the disciples that would follow after Jesus, learners of Christ, amen, the people of God. And I need you to know that the gospel works for more than just lust. The gospel works for more than just drugs or alcohol problems. And what I'm trying to talk to you about when I say that is, and many of you already know what I'm talking about, that for the longest time as a Christian, I did not understand how to walk in freedom and liberty in my life. I did not understand what the gospel was truly teaching as far as how freedom was given to mankind. And for so long, I was told by preachers, and I'm here to tell you that it's not true, That you give your heart to Jesus. I hope everybody in here has given their heart to Jesus. I hope that you've all received Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you haven't, you need right now, while I'm still preaching, tune me out and invite Jesus into your heart. Amen. Tell Him that you desire forgiveness of your sin, that you believed He died for you. That's just the beginning, though. I can remember when I first started preaching, I would tell people, you got saved, that's good, but that's just an introduction. That's kind of like if I met the President of the United States and I shook his hand, that doesn't mean I have a relationship with him. It just means that I'm basically not even really an acquaintance, but he knows my name. I've been introduced to him. But in order for me to have a relationship with somebody, then I have to get to know him. Amen. I have to get to know about him. And when it comes to Jesus, that I need you to know that the gospel and when you got saved is just the beginning. It's just an introduction into the faith. It's a big introduction. It's a big change, because whether you knew it or not, the old man that was born in Adam, that was born in sin, has now died with Jesus. Amen. The Bible teaches that the old man dies with Christ. He's buried with Him, and that a new man is resurrected to newness of life. And that the new man has access to grace. Amen. Grace changes things.
Amen.
I used to say this all the time too. I don't say it too much anymore, but grace is a change agent.
Yes.
It means when grace enters into the midst of a situation, things change supernaturally. Not you changing them, not you manipulating through your wisdom and your actions on how to fix a particular situation, but instead the grace of God, the grace that the Holy Spirit dispenses in your life, moving and operating and changing situations and circumstances. Amen? And so I need you to know that grace changes not just drug problems, not just alcohol problems, not just lust problems. Grace can also help worry problems.
Yeah.
Whatever it is that you're going through, whatever it is that you're worried about, I'm preaching to the preacher this morning. Whatever it is that you don't know how you're going to figure out what's going to happen tomorrow, right? Whenever things aren't going the way that you expected them to or the way that you wanted them to, and you don't really know what's going to happen tomorrow, guess what? Grace still works for that. The gospel still works for that. But what I wanted you to know is that Paul, before he talked to them about practical things, would talk to them about the gospel. And if you go back to Philippians 3, 9, and 10, we just spoke about this last week. I'm pretty sure this is what I preached on Sunday. Whenever Paul says right here that he wanted to be found in Him, not having his own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through faith of Christ. See, whenever I was just talking a little bit a while ago about what the preachers would tell me in the past, that my faith or my introduction into the faith when I got saved was that, okay, well, you put your faith in Christ, well, you did the right thing, but now in order to grow in the Lord, Now, in order to have grace flowing in your life, now in order to be free from lust, drugs, or alcohol, now in order to be free from worry or anxiousness or things that you're going through, you have to do these various things. And some of y'all know what I'm talking about. The preacher would say, you got to read this much. Now, he might not give you a formula, but he'd say, you got to read your Bible every day. You got to go to church however many times a week. You got to tell people about Jesus, and you got to spend time in prayer. And that was supposed to be the way that you were going to access the grace that you needed in order for God to move in your life. But I have to tell you that while all that's true, you'll never know this Jesus that I'm telling you about it unless you do all of those things. The Bible says don't forsake the gathering of the brethren. The word of God is life. Amen. It's how we learn about the faith. It's how we learn about Jesus. Right. Time in prayer. Thank God we can talk to him. Yes. Right. You know, all of those things are extremely important for our walk with God and being able to understand the Lord. But the reality is this, is that if we turn the focus of our faith onto what it is that we do, thinking that we, because we do these things, are going to have grace put in our lives, now we're in some way earning it. The Bible doesn't teach that. The Bible doesn't teach that you can earn grace from God. No, the Bible teaches that Jesus purchased grace for us. Amen. Jesus purchased grace for us when he died on the cross. Amen. And that now that we've put faith in him and we've become one with him, now we have access to the grace that we need. The Apostle Paul is teaching them this right here. Not having my own righteousness. You know, and I've drawn this for you many times on the board. But just to remind you again that to be in Christ means that whenever we were born the first time like Adam, we were born in sin. But when we became born again, we now became one with Jesus. And now we're in him. And I've said this before too, that whenever the eyes of the Father, I'm not a great artist, but you get the point. The eyes of the Father looking down upon us. Amen. He took Jesus, when we put our faith in Christ, he took us out of the world. We used to be in the world, and now we're in him. Amen. And now when the Father sees us, he sees us clothed with the righteousness of Christ. Amen. Because we're clothed with the righteousness of Christ, we have access to the grace of God. That's what the Bible says in Romans chapter 5. It's not because of any work that you do. No, it's because of the work that he did. It's faith in what he has done that clothes you with righteousness, not a righteousness that you get from the law, not a righteousness from the doing of works, but a righteousness that was not his own, Paul said, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, and that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. I went here because in the other passage of scripture in Philippians, Paul was telling the Philippian church, be careful for nothing. Don't be consumed with worry and anxiety, but instead bring your needs before the Lord, amen, with a thanksgiving heart. You can bring it to the Lord, but what I need you to understand is that the only reason you can even do that is because of this. Amen. The only reason that you can even have access to the presence of God, to the grace of God, is because of the fact that you are now righteous in the eyes of God because you chose to believe by faith the plan that the Father had from the beginning of time, which was the giving of his Son to die on the cross for your sin. Amen. Amen. And now being clothed in the righteousness of God, you can bring your petitions and your needs that you have before the Father. He wants to hear the concerns of your heart. Amen. He understands that there's legitimate things going on in your life. And he wants his will for your life to be done. He said, Paul said, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection. There's resurrection power in Christ. Amen. To be made conformable, he says, unto his death. It means to be in one, to take on the same form as. To take on the same form as Jesus. Jesus died in the physical. And now in Christ, we die. The old man born of Adam dies with him, and a new man is resurrected to newness of life. But going back to the part about being careful for nothing, what's interesting to me is that the root of this word describes a tearing apart or division. The idea is that anxiousness and worry about today consume our thoughts and minds and separate us from the purpose of God that He has for our lives for tomorrow. I like this quote by Corrie Ten Boom. I never did read her book, but I think it was called The Hiding Place or something like that. It was about that Jewish woman who was a child. Her and her sister were in a Nazi concentration camp, and she loved the Lord. She was hiding Jewish people from the Nazis, and she got caught. And this is what she said about worry. She said, "Worry does not empty tomorrow of its sorrow. Instead, it empties today of its strength." We become so consumed about today because of something that's going to take place in the future that we can't, that we lose our strength for today and ultimately to be able to do what God is calling us to do. Jesus said it right here in Luke 12:25. We already read it once this morning. He said, "And which of you, taking thought, can add to his stature one cubit?" The point is that if you're short, you're short. You can worry about it all day long. You cannot want to be short, but you're not going to be able to do anything about it. You're not going to be able to change it. If you have a dilemma, you have a dilemma. And worrying about it won't change it. But God can change it. And what moves God's hand is prayer that is prayed according to His will. God sees what we need, and He desires that His will for our lives would be done. Amen? That was point number one. Point number one, once again, was don't worry because it's not going to change anything. Amen? Point number two says, God takes care of what belongs to Him. In Luke chapter 12, verses 23 and 24, Jesus was telling His disciples that the life is more than meat and the body is more than raiment. He said, "Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse nor barn, and God feeds them. How much more are you better than the fowls?" In this passage of Scripture, God wants His disciples to know that He will take care of them. He wants us to know that He will take care of us. And He uses an unclean bird known as the raven to make the point. The raven was considered unclean by the Jewish people. But God still has concern that the raven gets its food. The raven doesn't sow seed, neither does he reap a harvest. He doesn't own storehouses like the rich man, but God makes sure that even the unclean raven has something to eat. God wants His people to trust Him, and He wants to provide for them. We shouldn't take this to mean that God doesn't want us to work or that it's okay for others to take care of us. It's important that we bring balance to the Scriptures. Because, you know, it's like, oh, okay, well, the raven, he just sits back and he just chills, and God makes sure he got some food, so I guess it's okay for me to sit back and I don't have to hit a lick. God's going to take care of me. No, that's not what the Word of God says. In 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 8, it says, let's give him a little time to put it up there. 1 Timothy 5:8. It says, But if any provide not for his own, and especially for those of his own house, he has denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. The word infidel right there, if you were going to see it in the Greek, it's apistos. And what it means is, it's describing a means without, and this is faith. Without faith, it's an unbeliever. That's what an infidel is. It's somebody that doesn't have faith. And so you can say that you're a believer, but if you're not working and you're not taking care of your family, then the truth is that in the eyes of the gospel, then you're worse than a person that doesn't even have faith. It says, instead, we should understand that God desires to do the right thing for His people. Psalm chapter 37, verses 1-4. This is what David said. We're talking again about the fact that God takes care of what belongs to Him. David said this. He said, "Fret not yourself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity." So he's saying, fret. Don't be anxious. Don't be overly concerned about the people of the world that are around you. And he's about to get into the fact that a little bit that they may have a lot. Whenever you look around at the people in the world, you may say, well, golly, they're blessed. He said, don't fret, don't be anxious or worried over the fact that they have some things, because he says, "For they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Instead, trust in the Lord and do good. So shall you dwell in the land, and verily you shall be fed." Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. David had come to the realization that he had to find his delight in the things of God. He had to find his delight in the things of the Lord. And then whenever he did that, that God would reciprocate with giving him the desires of his heart. Again, don't fret, don't be anxious, don't worry. Too often we look around at what others have and we want what they have. But David said, just like Jesus said to the rich man, their stuff is going to wither away like the grass. But for the heart that delights in the Lord, God will give him the desires of his heart. And the reason that God gives the desires of that man's heart is because as you delight yourself in the things of God, the Spirit of God begins to change your desires to line up with his desires. Amen. And when our desires line up with his desires, he can now begin to bless us and begin to move in the midst of our life in that situation. Number three, the world is consumed with the here and now. In Luke 12:30, Jesus says right here, this is at the end of the passage that we were reading. Jesus says, "For all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knows that you have need of these things." The nations of the world, describing the Gentiles, once again, describing those that are not the people of God, those that have no faith. Those that don't know the things of God. Those that aren't even concerned about the kingdom of God. That's what they're seeking after. The cares of today. The cares of the world of today. Consumed and concerned overly with what they're going to eat, with what they're going to wear, with what others around them have. It's the same spirit that's alive and well today that was alive and well then. Causing covetous desires, causing a desire in the hearts and lives of people to always want more and to never be satisfied with what it is that God has given them. We have to learn to allow God to convince us that we can trust him to take care of us. If we spend all of our time consumed with the cares of this world, we will once again never accomplish anything for God. And so that's what's really going on out there in the world, that people are, and you know what the sad thing is that they don't know the Lord. Amen. Many times people just don't know God. And so you can about imagine sometimes, even if we're honest with one another, even as Christians, sometimes we feel empty on the inside and we're still looking around and we're still desiring. There's a desire many times to try to add to. I mean, if we're going to be real with one another, right? So can you imagine somebody that doesn't even have Jesus? Can you imagine somebody that doesn't even have the Lord and how they feel? That's why it's so difficult for them to even understand what it is that you're trying to explain to them.
That's right.
Or to wrap their mind around the things of God. Amen? But my last point is this. Crave the things of God. Luke 12:31. So it says, "But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you." The word "seek" there literally means to crave. You know, when a person has a desire for something that's not of the Lord, their craving for it drives them forward, and they seek it with everything they have. Yet it's never enough. So they keep on searching. God wants us to feel that way about the things of God. He wants us to crave that his will would be done not only in our lives, but in the lives of others. He wants us to desire to seek after the kingdom like a treasure. And if we will do this, he promises to meet our needs. He promises to add to us the desires of our heart that will line up with his will for our lives. Amen. And so ultimately, I just wanted to encourage you this morning to not worry. Amen. No matter what it is that you're going through, no matter what it is that you're facing, don't worry. Don't be anxious. Don't try to figure it all out in your own strength, right? One day at a time. Trusting the Lord, bringing your needs before the Lord with prayer and supplication, and asking God to move in the midst of your situation and your circumstances. Amen.